Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The procession of hymn is found on page 1, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise.
Seated up faithfully the fruits of his redeeming work, and to follow daily in the blessed steps of his most holy life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, O Lord, who lives and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the readings.
A reading of the Word of God, written in Proverbs. Wisdom had built her house. She has sown her seven pillars. She has slaughtered her animals and has mixed her wine. She has also set her table. She has sent out her servant girls. She calls from the highest place in the town. You that are simple, turn in here. To those without sense, she says, come eat of my bread and drink of my wine I have mixed. Lay aside immaturity and live and walk in the way of the sight. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is Psalm 34. We will read the refrain together at the beginning and the end. I will read the odd verses and the congregation will read the even verses. We will pause at the asterisk. The refrain.
Faith is to see that the Lord is good.
Fear the Lord, you that are saints, that are his saints. For those who fear him lack nothing.
In the land, he lack and suffer hunger. But those who seek the Lord have nothing that is good.
Come, children, and listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord.
Who among you loves life? And desires long life to enjoy prosperity.
Keep your tongue from evil speaking, and your lips from lying words.
Turn from evil and good. Seek peace and pursue it.
The refrain?
Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, and as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
The second reading is from Ephesians. Be careful how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your heart, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The hymn for the graduate is on page number 2 of the bulletin. Like the woman at the well, I was seeking for things that could not satisfy.
I was seeking for
reading from the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, unless you eat of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You may be seated. Jesus said, if those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me and I in them. We have been following this gospel for weeks now, John's Gospel chapter 6, where Jesus makes the statement, makes the true fact that he is the living bread that came down from heaven. And so one wonders why the gospel continues with the same thing. You know, when we were children, we had to repeat when we were studying, especially those who are doing multiple, our timetables as we call them, and doing other things, parts of speech, we have to practice, we have to rehearse. And the more we say it, the more we hear it, is the more it can sink into our minds and our spirit. Isn't that so? Repetition is good. Sometimes we may find repetitions very annoying, but in this case, it is very good. Because Jesus was speaking to an audience of unbelievers, people who were there to accuse him, people who were not really interested in what he had to say because they did not believe that he was the Son of God, the Messiah, the chosen one of God. And so as he spoke to the Jews, the religious people, along with the Gentile community, he had to emphasize over and over and over that he is the bread that came down from heaven. And he said to them in last week's gospel, he said, listen, when they said that Moses was the one who gave their ancestors the bread to eat, he says, the bread that came from God to your ancestors in the wilderness was just the bread to sustain them for that time. But I am the living bread, the one that has come down to give life eternal. And then again, as I said last week, that Jesus is the best teacher as he walked the earth because he used what was familiar to them and to us now. Bread is the sustenance that we need for the energy and for other things. And so he says, I am that living bread, not just the bread, but the living bread which came down from heaven, the one who gives eternal life, the one who gives not just eternal life to time to come, but the one who helps us in our struggles, in our daily walk, in our experiences, in the rough times, in the smooth times. I am that one who gives the solace, the strength, the compassion, the energy, so that you can live to receive that eternal peace, that eternal life, where there may be no more destruction. So if you partake of me, and he was making also a slight reference to the Holy Eucharist, if you eat my flesh and drink my blood, then you have life. And remember on the cross that his flesh was broken, blood and water and blood flowed from his side. The cleansing blood, the salvific blood that gives to us life. So I am that bread, that living bread that came down. And he still could not get to them because they were still in that place of ignorance where they were wondering, why is this man telling us to eat his flesh? It's like, am I a cannibal? And that's how they saw it. And Jesus had to repeat, I am whoever abides in me. In John's Gospel chapter 15, Jesus says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then you are part of me, you belong to me. And if we look at a tree, when a branch is broken and put aside for a while, what happens to it eventually? It withers because it does not get the nutrients from the trunk. Jesus says, I am the vine. And he uses that case, the wine that they are accustomed to, the grapes. So when they take the grapes off the vine and it's put near the branches, it cannot bear. But if you abide in me, then you're a part of me. And so my brothers and sisters, on this morning, another day that God has loaned to us, we have to ask, am I abiding in God? Does God abide in my life? Can people see Christ in me? Or can I experience Christ in a way that in the midst of disasters, I can say, Lord, I do not understand, but Lord, because of who you are, I am trusting you. You are my Father. And that's what we just have to be. You know, we have been going through so many disasters. We have been going through disasters. And yesterday, there was a very catastrophic event and happened in Haiti and was felt in different parts of the Caribbean. And yet there also in Afghanistan, we find the wars, we find different places in Turkey, in the United States, in other places where the wildfires just blazing. We just have so many floodings. We have had violence, so many things. The COVID variants, the Delta is just spreading. And we say to God, how can I truly hold on to your word that you are the one who gives life if I abide in you? How do you help me in this crisis? And that is when we learn how to abide. When we learn to trust, when we learn to let go, in the midst of our confusion, in the midst of our fears, to let go and to allow God to guide us through. Because the times around us, as Paul writes to the people of Ephesus, he says, be careful how you live. Not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. And it comes at a time when we are going through so many things. He's saying, just be careful. Make sure that your trust, your faith is in God. Do not clamor for the things of the world. Do not live in quarrels and fights. Do not be people who are given into drunkenness. People who just do what they think that they want. People who are just living wild life, who think that the more they can have affairs, the more that we can have power, the more that we can say, who I am good. He says, be careful. There's a chorus of a song that says,
Signs of the time are everywhere, and there's a brand new feeling in the air. So keep your eyes on the eastern sky. Lift up your heads, your redemption draweth nigh.
So what he says is signs are all around. Our redemption draweth nigh. Jesus says, I am the living bread that came down, if you abide in me. So we can't afford to be caught up in that which is perishing around us. To whom do we look? In whom do we trust? Do we trust in what we see? Or do we trust in the one who has the blueprints for our lives? Do we trust him only when things are going well? Or do we trust him when things are not going the way? He says, get as the body of Christ. Now, this letter was written to the church. Be careful. Paul was not writing to the people who were not yet members, who were not following Christ. He says, be careful how you live. And I've said this different occasions, that when I first met the passage that says in Peter, that God is going to deal with those who are members of the body first. I could not understand as a young person, as a young Christian, why is God going to deal with us first? Because it should be the people who have not yet met him. But the thing is, to whom much is given, much is what?
Expected
of us. We're expected to live a certain way. We're expected to follow, to abide by Christ, by living for him, not living for ourselves, not just living in the moment. We're not here this morning to hang out. This is not a place to come to hang out. This is a place of worship, a place of that we come to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, a place for a change. We are here to worship, to do that which God wants us, so that God, when God equips us, we can go out and minister, not in our name, but in his name. Be careful how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making most of the time. So many people woke up yesterday morning, and they are not here this morning. There are persons who went to bed last night, and they're not here in this life. So it's a warning, it's an exhortation to all of us. Do not get caught up, but to sing the hymns, to come together, to worship, to bless the Lord, to be strengthened, and to trust in God, giving God thanks. And he says, also singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And sometimes it's hard to give God thanks when things are not going right. Isn't that so? But he says, and this is where our faith comes. You remember what Job went through? When Job heard all the things about his family, his children were dead, his castle, all his livestock. Everything was just going one after the other. And he tore his clothes and he worshiped. He worshiped God. And so we have to come when we abide in God, in the roughness, to just say, Lord, I bless you. I honor you. You know, I wrestle with it, but I say, God, in my heart of hearts, I do believe that you're a good God in the good times and in the bad times. But sometimes I'm not able to explain it to people who are going through a rough time, because God's goodness for them is that everything will be good at all times. But as Christians, we have come to know that part of following Jesus is that the struggles of life, struggles, not struggles that we go out for, but they come. Struggles of our faith. Am I going to trust him? Am I going to listen to God? The struggle to be a Christian at such a time as this. The struggle to be able to give an answer for the hope that lies within. That's the kind of life Jesus wants. To be ready to give an answer in the midst of strife, in the midst of joy. To eat, because when we eat his body and drink his blood, It's a remembrance of what he did on the cross. He suffered for us, that we may have life. And to have life is not just to come to the rail and to receive, but it's to do his will. In Psalm 90, verse 12, it is said, teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to what?
Wisdom.
To wisdom. Teach me to number my days, that I may apply my heart to wisdom. And the Old Testament lesson personified wisdom as a woman and said, she calls. She said, come to the simple mind, come and get wine, come and get that which will make you wise. And so, you know, there's a saying that saying common sense is not common anymore. But we have to be wise as God's children. We have to be wise in the seriousness of the days. We can't just live as if we have no possibility to live. Because one day we all have to give an account to God as to how we lived our lives. So it says, when we fear God, God does not withhold that from us. He says, anyone, as the psalmist says, turn from evil and do good and seek peace and pursue it if you want to have life. And so each of us are called to look at ourselves, to open ourselves before God, who sees the heart. God sees all our heart. God knows what we do. He knows if it's clean or filthy. No matter how much we hide, God sees. And if God were to call us home today, could we say, it is well with my soul? And that's what each of us have to think about. Not looking at somebody else, but looking at our own life. Can I say, it is well with my soul? And that's like what I have to work out. As the Bible says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling before God. Because we are before the Almighty God, the bread of life who gives life, the living bread that came down to show us how to live, how to walk the path of humility, the path of love, the sharing path, the path of forgiveness, the path of standing on the promises of God. How do we walk? How do we love the unlovable? That's what the living bread came down to show us. Because even this course in the gospel, they were not loving Jesus, but Jesus was still there amongst them saying, I am the living bread that came down to give life. And Jesus is all about life, eternal life, life in this life and life in the world to come. So we have to choose. We have to choose. And we have to know that no matter how much we eat the right things and we do all the exercises and we get all the vitamins and the creams and the operations to make us well, it cannot give us salvation. As Peter said in that sermon after the resurrection, he says in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, there is salvation in no one else. For there's no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved. And so we thank God for this opportunity. He has given us another opportunity for us to come and to make it right. We are now in the, you know, we do ultrasounds, x-rays, we do all sorts of things when we go to the doctor. But God, we're before God, x-ray machine. And God is looking and God is saying to us, I love you. Be careful how you live. Not as unwise people. Unwise people mean people who are not telling me that we come to the realization that there is a God. Some people still don't believe that there is a living God. They believe that they were just put on earth just like that. They came from apes. So there's nothing to give an account. But we who are called into wisdom, we are called to ensure that when that day comes, that we have an answer. We have as stewards, we can account to God as to what we did with the gifts. So as we come to the altar in a little while, which is an altar call, let us come before God with our brokenness. Come to God and say to him, Lord, I need you. As this, the Eucharistic prayer says, the body of Christ given for you, broken. When he took it up, he broke it. And he said, this is my body broken for you. Let us not see it just as that for the community, but just for us as individuals. So we give God thanks that he is the bread of life. And he has invited us to take part of his body and blood. Amen. We just sing the chorus. You don't have to play it really. We just, or if you're weird, you have it. We're just going to sing, fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up, and make me whole.
Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord.
We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker.
bring before God our brothers and sisters in Haiti. We bring before God our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan and all other places where disasters are happening. And we ask God to touch them and to let them know that He's a God who cares, a God who loves. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In peace we pray to the Lord, to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors. And for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. Today we pray for Mistress Marion Bryan, Mr. Richard Dobbins, Mr. Kyle Douglas, Mr. Christopher Green, Mistress Kate Green, Mistress Viola Green, Miss Allison Hodge, Mr. Bernard Hughes, Mr. William Jackson, Mistress Maggie Jones, Mrs. Dorothy McGraw, Mistress Gloria Sue, Miss Mikkel Simpson, Mistress Vilma Simpson, Mr. Philip Simpson, Mr. Carl Waters, Miss Irene Williams, Mistress Vernie Wills, Mr. Kevin Wint.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For the Right Reverend Michael Curry, Archbishop. The Right Reverend Andrew Dishi, the Assistant Bishop. For the Right Reverend Alan Shin, the Suffragan Bishop. And the Right Reverend Mary Gospel, the Assistant Bishop. And all bishops and other ministers, especially our Reverend Audrey Bailey.
For all who serve God in His church.
For the special needs and concern of this congregation. Bless us with more children, young people, and men who will work for your kingdom. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom.
And we bring before God at this time, Yvonne Ivy.
Sure.
And we bring before God Vivian. And may God rest your soul in peace.
Lord, let your loving kindness be upon us.
We'll put our trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy
on us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown. Things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in life eternal. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Jesus lifted me.
come into his courts.
Hymn for the offertory is found on page 5. Come thou font of every blessing.
Great Thanksgiving The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, In the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing.
Thank you.
post communion prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Jesus loves the little children.
Traveling. We ask you, dear God, even now, as there's so much fear and love the cause, that you protect them from the virus. We bash you that you protect them from defective vehicles, whether on land or in the air or on the waters. We ask you, dear God, that they will all know, and as we all travel from place to place, that we'll be mindful of your holy presence with us. So protect them and bring them back safely, and guide us to where we're all going today. In your name we pray. Amen. Please stand and bow your heads. And we spend a moment in silence for those who died in that earthquake yesterday and the other disasters around the world. Or sudden death or death through illness. May the souls of the faithful, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, rest, remain, and abide with you and with your loved ones, near or far, now and forever. Amen.
We now have our theme song on page number 9. We're one in the Spirit, we're one in the Lord. Afternoon.
which is St. Francis Martyr at gmail.com. And please continue to bring the non-precious items for the darkest basket. Remember, God loves a cheerful giver.
Amen.
The thought for the week. Do not judge me by my success. Judge me by how many times I fell down and got back up again. Nelson Mandela.
Yes, thanks, yes. And also we extend our condolences to Dr. Janice Hyman. Her mother died yesterday. So please keep the family in your prayers at this time, and all others was grieving. And whenever we're called, I know we like to give. So as people out there in Haiti, you know, people are wondering why we all the time are in Haiti. All the time, as one disaster stops, another one begins. But we just have to keep praying one for another and begging God to help us. Okay, so it's Bible praise. Hagar was the mother of?
Ishmael.
What was the name of Isaac's wife?
Rebecca.
How many years did Jacob serve his uncle Laban in order to marry his daughters?
14 years.
14. Remember the first 7 years he had to work for one, and then he tricked him and gave him one, and then he had to work another 7 years. Okay, that's good. Who succeeded Moses and led the children of Israel into the prison? The promised land.
Joshua.
Okay. What is the sign of the covenant relationship between God and the children of Israel? What is the covenant relationship? What is the sign of the covenant? I didn't hear you, Brian. No. I think I heard somebody say
circumcision.
Circumcision was a sign when God made a covenant with Abraham, who became Abraham. He says that all the males had to be circumcised. And the babies, when they reach 8 days of 8 days old. Okay. How many times on the last day did the children of Israel march around the walls of Jericho and gain victory?
Seven.
Okay, yes. What were they given permission to do on that day before they took over Jericho?
Shout.
They were to shout, remember? They were been walking around Jericho for days. But on the seventh day, they were to march and they were to shout, and the victory would have been theirs. Okay, that's good. What was the advice Naomi gave to her daughter-in-law Ruth to attract Boaz's attention?
Yeah,
that, yes, when the time of the gathering, she was to go at his feet, and when he, you know, when he's awake, then he would see. And that's how he was meant to be attracted to her. What is the, in the vision, which Isaiah had in the temple, what was the question he heard asked, and what was the answer given? Remember when he was in the temple? And he had a vision. Isaiah chapter 6, you can read it when you get home. When the Lord says, whom shall go for us? Whom shall we send? And he said, Isaiah replied, here I am, send me. Remember after the angel touched his tongue? That was what happened in the temple. Which is the shortest chapter in the book of Psalms? Chapter, not verse. Psalm 117 is the shortest chapter in the Psalm. You can check it when you get home. You don't have your Bible, so you can't cheat. Ecclesiastes comes after the book of?
Proverbs.
I'm asking the question.
Proverbs.
Is that a certainty or is that a guess?
Proverbs.
Okay. All right. Where in the Bible it is written? It is the mercies It is the Lord's mercy, they are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Yeah, but where? What chapter? Okay, give me the chapter. Chapter 3 of Lamentation. And who wrote Lamentation? Who wrote the book of Lamentation? Jeremiah wrote the book of Lamentation. And that's where we get the song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies we see. Yes. Who wanted to die? Because the people, a people of a certain place, had repented of their wickedness and turned to God.
Jonah.
And who are the people? The people of Nineveh.
Okay.
And you notice they're all from the Old Testament this week. Yes, get us into the Old Testament. And let us say the verse of the week together. Rejoice
in hope.
Be patient in tribulation.
Be constant in prayer.
12, verse 12. For those who are watching live, we just apologize, as we did bring up. It's going to be uploaded in a little while. For some reason, technology, we can't put our faith in technology. But something went wrong this morning for those who started.